What are the top lab and preventive tests diabetics must include post-diagnosis? Not only can these tests extend one's life, but help with blood sugar control, which will thwart all the unwanted complications associated with this disease. These are the tests my doctors missed and could also save you years of anguish, misery, and pain. But before we begin, let me welcome all of you resilient diabetics out there. This is the channel we turn ordinary, struggling diabetics into extraordinary, well-controlled diabetics. If you don't know who I am and you are brand new to this channel, I welcome you. My name is Jay Sampat, and I became an insulin-dependent diabetic a little over 6 years ago due to an autoimmune attack which caused the destruction of my pancreas as a result of a severe gluten allergy attack. So basically, I am the proud owner of a pancreas that's gone on a permanent and lifelong vacation. So not only am I a diabetic just like you, where we will be walking that walk and talking the talk together, but I do also have a University of Bachelor of Science degree in nutrition dietetics. And that does come in very handy in discussing all the intricacies of being a diabetic. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button followed by the gray notification bell. Then choose turn on all notifications if you want to be notified when a new Resilient Diabetic video has been published. As with all my videos, this should not be considered personal medical advice. This is my interpretation of the latest research. If you want medical advice, please always consult your physician. Diabetes is now one of the most common diagnoses made by family physicians. Both uncontrolled and controlled diabetes with higher than normal blood sugars can lead to blindness, limb amputation, kidney failure, and vascular and heart disease. The main problem we all face, each one of our doctors and healthcare institutions have different standards and different treatment plans for this growing epidemic. So you will undoubtedly face two issues. One comes down to the minimizing of cost by requiring the most basic of tests. The second, the main battle and the disagreement will come down to your A1C and what level is appropriate for your specific diagnosis. Some doctors want an A1C in the fours for all of their diabetic patients, including type 1s and type 2s. Then you have other doctors who want A1Cs in the sixes, and some are even comfortable with A1Cs in the sevens. If your doctor happens to be wrong with your corresponding A1C, it is your suffering and your loss of life that is at stake. The new studies that look at the A1C levels in people with and without diabetes shows that for every 1% increase in the A1C upped the risk of death from all causes by 24% in men and 28% in women. Every 1% rise in A1C added an 18% to a person's risk of heart disease, and there was a 28% jump in peripheral vascular disease. So basically, every 1% change is clinically significant to our health. Every diabetic, regardless of type, should know why our doctors and the American Diabetes Association recommends higher than normal A1Cs. Shouldn't we have the right to normal blood sugars like every non-diabetic would? And we have discussed this in the video, how long can you live with diabetes? It comes down to the bottom line and the liability issues for our healthcare institutions, not our well-being. I'll create a link in the description box to that all-important video. So then, how do we as diabetics hedge our bets when it comes to the right test to ensure our health? Because we are just another number in this overburdened healthcare system. This disease in particular requires us to take charge of our own destiny and our fate. Besides the basics of the A1C, what test would you want to have done, especially ones your doctor may not have ordered? And I wish I had this piece of information you're getting today on the day I was diagnosed, or should I say misdiagnosed? And the reason for the misdiagnosis and the years of unnecessary suffering was because the right tests were never ordered or even done until I demanded them. The first set of tests we will discuss are related to your pancreas and pancreatic burnout, but these tests would take the right doctors familiar with each test. They are usually better interpreted by your endocrinologist, but as many of you may find out, the endocrinologists are generally sometimes the hardest to work alongside with due to their very strong, unwavering stances. The first is the C-peptide test. The pancreas produces this protein along with insulin. Low levels of C-peptide in the blood can suggest low levels of insulin. Thus, it shows how much your pancreas is producing. Once you have a baseline, you can then determine how your pancreas is doing over time. By the way, this also needs a glucose test done alongside for accurate interpretations. The C-peptide test will ultimately determine if and when you may need insulin. The second is the insulin antibodies. This test checks for the presence of proteins that target and destroy insulin. Third is the glutamic acid decarboxylase antibodies, also known as the GADA test. This test checks for the presence of antibodies that can destroy the insulin-producing beta cells of the pancreas. After my C-peptide and GADA tests were done, I then insisted on an endocrinologist. It was then I was retyped from a type 2 diabetic to a type 1 insulin-dependent diabetic. This proactive stance saved my life. The second blood test I wish I had done on day one is a complete thyroid check. And to help you understand some of the complexities, I will share some of my personal blood work with you today. It is not uncommon for someone to have both thyroid disease and diabetes. In fact, if you have type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, insulin resistance, or metabolic syndrome, your risk of thyroid disease is increased. I am one of those that has gone a long time with a thyroid dysfunction. It's better late than never, and that was my mistake. I should have asked for more intensive tests from day one. Type 1 diabetes and thyroid disease can be caused by the autoimmune process in which the body attacks itself. If you have one autoimmune disease, such as diabetes, this increases your risk of developing other autoimmune diseases, such as thyroid disease. So it is important then to make sure you undergo screening for thyroid disease and vice versa to ensure early detection and a timely treatment. When one of these conditions is poorly controlled, it can make management of the other condition even more difficult. Because thyroid disease interferes with metabolism, it can alter your blood sugar levels and it can make it harder to manage your blood sugars if you concurrently have diabetes. Many hypothyroid patients also find themselves consuming very few calories while also having a big problem losing weight. Thyroid disease is one of the most complicated of diseases, and so is the list of very confusing potential panels that can be run. More than likely to save costs, your provider may only run what's known as the TSH test. And yes, the TSH tests are very accurate and sensitive. They can help diagnose even the mildest cases of hypothyroidism. It is important to understand that if your TSH comes back normal, it does not rule out the possibility of you still being hypothyroid. Here are my TSH results over time. And as you can see, it's been all over the place. So that is why I recently asked for additional tests. The TSH by itself may fall short of showing what's going on inside your body. And that is what happened to me. Your doctors may then measure your levels of free T4. Free T4 is what is directly available to your tissues in your bloodstream. And here are my free T4 results, way below the threshold. My total T3 and total T4 were also just as bad as you can see. Just to reiterate, my healthcare team would never have run these additional tests without my aggressive stance. But unfortunately, asking your doc to run all the thyroid tests on the potential list may not be helpful for the following reasons. If you have to even ask for these tests, then there's a high probability that your current provider may not treat you appropriately. Many physicians are set in their ways and are unwilling to change their practice style regardless of the data right in front of them. The next labs that were missed upon my diagnosis was the vitamin D panel. Again, lo and behold, when pressed and demanded for this test, it too came back pathetically low. Vitamin D is not just necessary to keep our bones strong, for muscle movement, and to keep our immune system working. It appears equally important for a healthy thyroid function as well as cardiovascular health. The other major factor, vitamin D appears to help with allowing the beta cells in the pancreas that make insulin to stay healthy and functional. Vitamin D also acts to reduce inflammation, which is the major process in inducing insulin resistance. It is first always best to try and meet your nutritional needs through diet first. Vitamin D is a fat-soluble vitamin, so it will be found in fatty protein-based foods. Salmon, tuna, mackerel are some of the best sources of vitamin D, and they provide heart-healthy fatty acids too. Dairy products including cheese, fortified milk, yogurt, and egg yolks are good sources of vitamin D too. And as you can tell, even with me, it can be difficult to get enough vitamin D from foods and sunlight alone, so vitamin D supplementation may be warranted. But heed my warning, the internet is still full of seedy, unscrupulous characters pushing incredibly high doses of vitamin D. Taking high doses of vitamin D for long periods of time can lead to some very troubling side effects. Especially for us diabetics, it can raise calcium in the blood to critical levels. Excessive levels of calcium in the blood can actually weaken your bones, cause kidney stones, and interfere with the basic functions of the heart and the brain. The excessive vitamin D and calcium is dangerous for other health conditions, including kidney disease, which you and I both know is common amongst us diabetics. I would personally work with your doctors just to get the vitamin D into the normal ranges. Now, what about some of the non-lab work, which are just as critical and important to have run? The first on that list is to have a continuous blood pressure check. And as you know already from my video, Diabetes and Blood Pressure, which I'll put a link in the description box below, diabetes and blood pressure go together, and I explained why. So if you're on that recommended high carbohydrate intake, check your blood pressure regularly. There is a reason high blood pressure is commonly referred to as the silent killer. There are no symptoms. So remember, besides blood sugar, blood pressure is also a very important value you should always know. Next is the eye check. Eye complications develop gradually. At first, there may be no noticeable symptoms or visual impairment, but if blood sugars remain elevated for long periods of time, it can and will damage the eyes. Elevated blood sugars affect the blood vessels of the retina, so there is a risk of damaging the back of the eye. But make sure you get the dilated eye exam. The dilated eye exam is different from the eye exam you get for glasses and contact lenses. When you get a dilated eye exam, you are given eye drops that help give the eye doctor a better look at the blood vessels deep inside the eyes. Next on our list is regular kidney checks. And I've said this numerous times. There are reasons for the explosion of dialysis centers opening up at what seems like every street corner. There were none 20 years ago. So who are they catering to? Yes, us diabetics. Remember, 1 in 3 is now pre-diabetic, all due to the high carbohydrate, high A1C models that are pushed upon us. Next, your routine foot check may not seem like much, but it will inform you if your blood sugars are already causing damage. The long nerves of the feet are the first warning signs. Loss of sensation or a weak pulse in the feet can be signs of nerve and blood vessel damage from elevated blood sugars. So it is important to have your feet checked regularly. But don't worry, if you've never had this done before, it not only takes just a few minutes, it is absolutely painless, but it actually tickles. If you don't find and treat those foot problems at an early stage, they can and would lead to amputation or the surgical removal of toes and feet. We've also got the dental check. And I bet you're thinking, what do teeth have to do with diabetes? Yes, there is a connection there too. People with diabetes have 3 times higher risk of gingivitis and or severe gum inflammation compared to people without diabetes. The higher the sugar levels, the more likely we are to have gum inflammation and in some cases, severe tooth loss. The inflammation of the gums and the bacteria that enters the bloodstream then increases blood glucose levels as well as the needed increase of insulin. Believe it or not, bad teeth and inflamed gums are one of the reasons many diabetics cannot control their blood sugars. So to prevent gingivitis, never skip your dental checkups. I will set up a direct playlist for you at the end of this video directly on the foods that help keep my A1C low and controlled. In the episode, Diabetes and Protein, you will come to find out protein may be the single most important nutrient for a diabetic to consume for the greatest possible health outcome. What are the top 3 vegetables to consume and why? What about breads? Are they to blame for the first known cases of type 2 diabetes found in the ancient world and for the recent explosion of diabetes found in the modern world? If you're on your desktop or laptop, I want you to use your mouse to click that upcoming box. If you're on a mobile device, tap that with your fingers. The first is the link to subscribe to this all-important, life-changing channel. The second is the link to the playlist mentioned on foods. So, have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new video, which are generally released weekly. Bye for now.